Hello, hello, I'm Li Hao. In the last videos, we talked about reactivity, as well as we talked about reactive declarations and statements. And I think it's time for us to talk about the tick function. So what is tick? Well, tick is a built-in function from Svelte that returns a promise, and this promise will be resolved when the update is finished, right? Right after, as soon as any updates, any pending updates that is already applied to the DOM, then the tick, the promise returns from the tick function will be resolved. Enough with this definition. Let's take a look exactly what it is. So over here, I've prepared an example. Over here, you can see that this is what we left off from the reactive declarations video. If you haven't watched that, links in the description. So over here, we talk about, if you remember, I talk about reactive declarations are evaluated asynchronously. They are evaluated right before Svelte applies the changes to the DOM, right? Right before. So over here, if you have an increment, over here, you have a double reactive declared double that is always two times of count. But in this function increments, when you increment count, double is not, this statement is not evaluated immediately, right? So over here, if you console out double, you will still get the old value. So if I click over here, you can still see that it's showing 4, but it's already updated to 6. So how do we make sure, if we really want to get the value of double to be the latest value, what should we do over here? Well, we talk about tick function, right? So obviously we're going to use the tick. So you're going to import tick from Svelte. And tick is a function that returns a promise. So you can use .then when the promise resolve. And when it resolve, which means that all the changes that's going to be made has already been applied to the DOM. Meaning DOM changes has been applied. Meaning this double has been already updated to the latest value, right? This statement will be evaluated right before you apply changes. So when changes has already applied, definitely double is already two times of the latest value of the count. So come over here and I move this double in. All right, so this, I'm going to say after tick. And just for comparison, I'm going to come over here and say before tick. So let me click on the button. You can see that before tick will get 2 because this is evaluated synchronously. And then when Svelte decides to update, because there's a change, Svelte decides to update the DOM and it evaluate this double. And then it will apply all the changes. You see 2 times 2 equals to 4 on the screen. And then this promise returns from tick will be resolved, which you can then console this value out. So this, although it seems that it's coming right after another, but it's actually a run a little bit longer than that, right? So if I come over here, if I say, if you're familiar with asynchronous and synchronous, you should know that this happens asynchronously. So it's way after. Even if I put before here, you should see that before comes way earlier before the after tick. So this tick function it returns a promise, and sometimes I don't really like to use the then. This is just my personal preference. Sometimes I like to change the function to be a asynchronous function so that I can await the tick. So I come over here, await the tick, and then console this out over here. So this is the same. This is the same behavior as what we've seen before. Instead of it's just that I can use async await so that it's less nested. I would say because I don't have to do the callback function in the dot then, it feels like it's nested in. Since it's one straight line, I can wait for this promise to resolve and then do my thing over here. So it's the same thing. It's just my personal preference of writing it. So what are the use cases of this tick function? Well, I prepared another example that you can use this tick function as well. So I'm going to import this component called input.svelte. So let me comment out everything and just show the input. So this input, we've learned how you can add event listeners, right? So I add an input event listeners. So every time when something has changed, I will update the value to be whatever the value of the input to uppercase. So right now I have my, okay. So just to show the effect, I comment out the to uppercase. When I type anything, the value will, the value, because we're passing in the value in, so the value will be whatever I'm typing in, right? So I don't have my caps lock on, but when I type something, you see that it will automatically converts to uppercase because the two uppercase will convert the value and then you get an uppercase value of the value and you pass it in and then you update the input. However, this way of updating the value of the input, because the input, the value of the input originally is lowercase, and then you assign it to a value, and then you have to use this variable value to assign the input value, right? You're calling, internally it's calling input of value to this new value that we evaluated, and this value is not the same as whatever it's internally in the input. So what happens is that it will clear whatever state you have within the input. It's a bit, I'm not sure whether I describe it well enough, but what it means is that if I come over here, I type something and I try to highlight something. And when I try to highlight something, there's an internal state of this input. So if at this point of time, I try to change the input value programmatically, right? If I don't do anything and I change the value programmatically, it will lose its state. It will clear all the text and then replace with a new text. And what happens is that right now, if I manually type some, let's come over here. I have a button, right? Just to demonstrate this. On click. If I come over here and I say value equals to XXX, right? So I type something, I highlight something, and as soon as I click, oh, okay. I think we need to set some timeout over here then. I want to make sure that we are still in focus of the input. So when I click, I have 3 seconds before it's being triggered. All right, so I try to type something, highlight something. Okay, no, I can highlight something. And as you see, when the value updated, the cursor will shift all the way to the right, right? Because you change the text, right? There's no way to restore the cursor position. So even if you come over here and you do something like value equals to value to uppercase, because just now we changed it to XXX, right? Definitely there's no way to restore the cursor. But if you come over here, type something all lower caps, now highlight something, and then I change everything to uppercase, you see that my cursor jumps all the way to the back. So that's annoying actually. If you haven't realized it yet, this is actually very annoying, especially when you implement this updating the value within input handler. Meaning if you come over here, you try and type something and I highlight something and I'm supposed to press on Q right now, it jumps all the way to the back, and I type Q again, you see that it's typing at the end of it instead of like where my cursor was supposed to be. So how should I solve this? Well, I can save the selection start and end of where the, I can get the selection start and end from the input. So I can come over here and say let's selection start equals to this input.selection start, and get the end of as well. And once I change this value, I want to restore the selection, right? Input our selection starts equals to selection start. So once I update, I want to restore it. So let's try and see. So if I type, okay, right now I'm going to type Q. I'm going to press Q, Q. But it still jumps all the way to the back. Well, at this point of time, you probably should realize that, yes, you change the value, but then the updates happens far later on, right? Asynchronously. As we have seen, if you want to have a reactive statements and you console out immediately, it does not update immediately because you haven't updated the DOM. So any changes right now, happening right now, the DOM hasn't updated yet. So we haven't really actually called input.value equals value internally within Svelte yet. So the only way to wait for it to happen before we restore back the selection is to use tick. So we come over here, import tick. And I'm gonna come over here and I want to await for the tick. So I can't use await unless I make my function async. So I come over async function, wait for the tick. So wait for it to update the DOM. So internally, this will be called to update the DOM value. And then we restore the input selection and start and end. So let's see what's the end result of this. All right, so I'm gonna type ASDF, ASDF. Okay, I think I'm gonna type AAA so that it's more obvious. I'm gonna highlight this 3A and I'm gonna press Q right now. Q. You see the cursor is still maintained at where I was. And press Q, Q, Q. And that it is. That is what we are achieving. So tick allows you to wait for DOM updates to be applied. So it returns a promise so that when this promise resolve, all the DOM updates has been applied, and then you can do something with it. So you can check any value of the reactively declared variables, or you can make some changes to the DOM, or you get any updated value of the DOM, right? You can probably, instead of getting selection of the inputs, you can maybe right before you make changes, check the scroll position of your elements, and then you add new items, updates, and wait for that update to happen. Wait up all the updates to finish before you say restore the scroll position or something like that, right? So tick will be very useful in that sense. So hopefully you learned something. If you have any questions, feel free to comment down below. And if you like this video, give me a thumbs up. And as always, remember to subscribe to my channel so that you get notified when the next one is out. So see ya. Bye-bye.